I want to record.
I tried putting this in,
yeah,
but it took about 10 pages, so I'm going to wear my opera glasses. Anyway, thanks, folks. Al and I were born on the same day, actually. March 26th, 23 years apart. That makes us soulmates. Al told me he used to attend my office, my father's office parties at DC Simpson, some architects that did the library and Marble and stuff. Anyway, the office parties on Fridays, they were quite well known. These weren't teetotaling events, you could say. The libations were flowing. Anyway, and I never knew exactly how Al got to these. How did he end up at my dad's office party? But then I discovered that he had lived in the basement suite of a house on Ambleside Beach owned by a landscape architect that worked for my dad, Harry Webb, who's Harry and Jesse Webb just had a lovely book done on Mother Tongue Publishing. So that's really worth looking at. There's lots about Al in that direction. It's interesting. So Harry was the guy that also painted the mural at the cellar. Of course, the club that Al founded in a basement of a house in Richmond originally. And then they moved over to Watson Street just here in the 50s. Some images coming in. Al takes cover under a lifeboat on Juno Beach during D-Day. I mean, he did. He told me that he, you know, rather than get machine gun, he hid under this lifeboat over here in my coat. He didn't talk much about the war. None of them do. But every time I'm in France, which is every chance I get, I give thought to the fact that Al staked his life, risked his life, so that I could be there having exhibitions. He didn't know that at the time, actually, but or sitting in with jazz groups, as I did a few years ago in Normandy, of all places. The image of beat poet and painter Kurt Lang taking me down at age 18 to meet Al in his Pendle Street Merzbau, which it was. And Kurt, when he was young, had been taken down to the very Dollar and Beats that Al would later move to by Canadian poet Al Purdy. That was to meet Malcolm Lowry. So, a lot of dovetailing there. The image of, Al told me, oh, this is good, as a lighthouse keeper at Point Atkinson, which he was doing when I met him, he was like swamping groceries, as they called it, or he was working at the post office part-time. We won't go into some of those stories. But anyway, the Point Atkinson Lighthouse, and I think I visited him there once, quite positively. Because it was I had to talk Al into actually continuing playing. He really stopped. He'd just given up. The attitude was rather restrictive for him, I think, artistically, in just the pure, you know, bebop music he was doing. Anyway, the weather reports that were given by various stations were always at odds with what Al was reporting. Live here in Richmond would be met with bright and sunny out here from Al and the best band. It was always bright and sunny somehow. He was up three or four days before he did that. But he was often told that getting back to the music, just play the changes, Al. Just don't do that weird shit. Just play the changes. So at the breaks, he would go back up and play solo piano, which is where the music we play actually kind of developed out of, the sort of modal sort of Bill Evans on something. Well, Bill Evans was on something, so. Then I heard him play at the Java Jive Club, which was the precursor of the Flat Five on Carnot Beach, of all places. I mean, what a strange club. And he was playing with Jim Chivers on drums, Dale Hillary on alto, and Richard Anstey on bass. And Richard was the guy that, in a way, got Al and I together, because he was playing with him and I was playing with Richard in this thing called the New Dimension Jazz Trio, which was a very strange band that played all over the place, though. It was a 12-foot-long marimba xylophone, bass and drums. I mean, we'd play a bebop tune that we learned off the record and then just solo. We didn't have a clue about what the chord changes were, but we were very proud. Well, and I was still in high school when all this was going on. So just play the changes. Okay, well, then when we had some rehearsals where Al broke all the keys on his electric piano, and he had charts that were old magazine cut-ups, girly magazines, all this stuff, as the charts, right? The whole different one, and I quit university. Yes, sir. But when Richard and I joined to form the trio in '65, I decided to rent a painting studio, because I was living at home, I didn't have any room to work, in a storefront at 4th and Bayswater. We moved in to rent a piano and heated the place with a little space heater. I mean, it was freezing. And Richard's neighborhood friends would sort of hang out and pay like $5 or $10 to keep this place open. And it was, you know, we didn't actually open it to the public though until March 66. And that's a bit later. But first of all, we played bebop standards like Dizzy Gillespie's Burke's Work, Monks Around Midnight, Celia by Bud Powell, which he played all his life. We also played some standards like Bobby Blackbird and what is the thing called? But yeah, Al's favorite pianists were Bud Powell at the top, especially his early work, and then Elmo Hope, who we'd seen at the Suburb with Harold Land, which is just, you know, incredible. And he sat underneath the piano to listen to him, apparently. And Sonny Clark is another one. Anyway, so he liked the real hard bop guys. Bebop period didn't last very long. I think I have a little bit of it on tape. I lost most of it, unfortunately. But we, at the same time, we saw John Cage and Merce Cunningham at UBC, and linked by sort of a shared sense of humor and the absurd, we invented our own form of audio collage with Al reading from the writings of Thomas Merton. I mean, Al had told me at one point he wanted to be a priest. He thought, when he was young. And I thought, Irish, right? He's not going to be a church minister, so luckily for us, he didn't, though. Or is it Thomas Merton? Alchemical Writings by Jacob Bohm. And he's reading this stuff out of about 4 books, okay? And he would do this at parties. And it's a lot of fun at a party. And I'm playing Spike Jonze albums, or this Mad Magazine record. I was actually going to bring it because that's Alfred E. Newman. Big Albert E. Newman picture, more tapes and radios and all the stuff. And eventually I hooked it up through an old switchboard, like a, with these clacking things that you could hear it on the tapes. You could hear clack on and a new source coming. I mean, this is low tech, really low tech. And the Gregorian chanting of the monks of Gethsemane, which you quite like. And there's a piece on the CBC, The Enterprise, which is called God is Love. And Al sings God is Love, the old hymn, right? And I'm recording it through a double tape loop, which I kind of actually figured out myself, even though it's quite common. So you play it, record it on the first head, run it through to the second head, which plays back on the first, and it just builds up this swirling vortex of sound. We finished that God is Love piece on the CBC. It's TV, I mean, it's on YouTube. And Al said, that scared me to death. Yeah. And now back to the axe. That was his favorite expression. He's just, let's just play. Back to the axe. Okay, in fact, we shared an interest in collage and in data. Al especially liked Kurt Schwitters, who made the original Merzbau. I was happy last year to lend him and Carol the massive book on the artist, which I had colored plates and had for years. And then down 4th Avenue, just continuing with the 66 thing, I'm not going too far, don't worry, is another similar group to them, was a little group, Sam Perry, Garrity Nova, Ken Ryan, and composer Jerry Walker, and they joined with us in 1966. We opened as the Sound Gallery, which was the name I came up with, envisioning, I suppose, the multimedia era to come. So it's, you know, I just thought, too, it's kind of funny, the Impressionists had their first show of their paintings in the photography studio of Nadar in 1860, whatever it was. So this is kind of the reverse. It's a painting studio that this media art is coming out of. So it works both ways, I guess. Meaningless, but it's kind of interesting. Weekend performances were held, and dance, light projections, and poetry mixed in with the music of the trio. We had like Milton Acorn reading I Tasted My Blood there. And we had Judith Cockthorne doing her seagull dance in front of Sam Perry's projections of seagulls. I mean, it was pretty neat, to say the least. Weekend performances, and then, okay, now here's a funny one. Al would often exit the place and simply walk straight ahead to the car, except it wasn't always mine. He seemed to assume I would just park in front of wherever he thought. I don't know if he's told me that. There's a car, okay. Eventually, Al tried to get into a car occupied by an elderly lady who was understandably freaked out when he approached her door and tried to get in. I mean, it was quite funny. And then some memories from 66 later, when the house burned down in the West End. A bunch of us lugging an old piano down through the woods to Al's cabin. no trails at that point, so it was tough sledding.
Yeah, I don't know how we did that.
Playing at the Trip Festival on a bill with the Grateful Dead, Janis Joplin, Big Brother, and Holding Company, my host. Michael McClure, poetry, The Daily Flash, Quicksilver Messengers. I mean, it was quite an amazing thing on Trip Festival. It's a bit like a Facebook group. Trip Festival Facebook group. But it's come down to him, right? And watching the lead guitarist, I think his name is Gurney or something. Jim Gurney.
James Burley,
yeah. Beaming over the fence at a 42-year-old pianist tried to discover along with his 19-year-old bandmates a way to mix like another piano trio music. And this was not Cocktail Lounge, that's for sure. I like the way Richard's Arco bass lines with Bo and his vocals that he combined with his Arco playing. And combined with Al was just something else. Really, I mean, it's some of the best stuff that was ever done of that type. Another image from an evening playing at the Motion Studio, the successor to the Soundgarden. You can read about this on the website, which I've listed up there. Which was at 1266 Seymour when the first strobe light came to town, among other things. And the audience included David Silcox from the Gannett Council, who's the director of the Gannett Council, and the master painter of musical Mandalas, Jack Wise. So they were there that night. It was like a magical night. It was an electrifying evening with the inevitable solo piano ballad where Al reworked modal jazz, transfixing the mainly young audience. People would just sit there spellbound. They never heard anything like it. And it was so poignant, the solo piano pieces you do. Very slow, you know, very meditative. At this time, jazz itself was going through big changes, with the hard bop and modal styles being made somewhat outdated, not irrelevant, by free jazz. So what we were playing reflected the same shift, so we were changing our playing at the very time the playing of all was changing. I learned format from Charles and pretty amazing time in music. It was like being in Paris, and Cubism and abstraction were before. The Vancouver scene was actually a bit like Montparnasse in the 1920s. Haven't been there for I mean, a Montparnasse, but not in the 20s. Or the Village in the 40s. A lot of raw energy not yet channeled into anything institutional or grant funded. Because of this, we were naturally all broke. Yes, obviously. Everybody was broke. I kind of played in strip clubs, you know. While I was playing with Alan, backing up dancers at the Smiling Buddha, you know. Or worse. Don Thompson, who had played with Al in the early 60s, asked him when he heard the Trio recordings, which is on the double CD. He said, Al, how do you get those guys to play like that? Because it was a little different than what Terry Clark and him were doing with John Handy, which was fantastic, but it was much more metric. It wasn't as free, you know. Anyway, so the answer is that Al made it easy. He just listened. We never felt like his accompanists. We were all collaborators, following Al's lead, of course, but he treated us as equals, which was really true. I don't like the word collaborators anymore. It sounds like Occupied France or something. Must be another word for it. And he always said, no matter how out there he got, that I still like to think I'm playing jazz. I heard him say that several times. The Trio broke up in 1968 when Richard left, but Al and I continued as a duo and were joined in 1969 by his wife at the time, Marguerite, on violin and vocals. And funny story there is that we were rehearsing at my mom's house, and you know, she was used to Marguerite sort of sitting there in the living room. And I said, now she's playing violin with us. And my mom said, I didn't know Marguerite could play violin. And I said, she didn't know either. My mom was an opera singer, so she heard everything. Yes. Okay, we toured to Toronto, playing with the Symbolist exhibition at the HEO and the Sculpture Corps. It was just like an unbelievable exhibition. Blake to Kandinsky, all the Symbolists, the whole bit. Fantastic. And then Regina and Edmonton. And Regina, we were treated by gallery director Terry Fenton, who played at his gallery in Norman and Fancy, to a meeting of painter Art McKay, who's one of the famous Saskatchewan group. So that was it. And in Edmonton, the concert at the university had one strange woman. I just about forgotten about this. When in response to Al's shamanistic performance, a student came up and started to read a newspaper out loud on the stage, and we thought, oh, this is the beginning of some kind of insurrection or something. And I think the school choir started singing.
Strange event. A little worrisome. They thought, well, we're gonna get into the spirit gap, I suppose. Now, around this time, there was another rather surreal moment. Al had written to composer Harry Partch, inventor of the 72-tone scale, played on his very weird instruments that he made. I mean, if you don't know Partch, you gotta check him out. He's probably all over YouTube. And then Partch sent him an LP of the piece Bewitched. I've actually seen it. It's in paper cover. Bewitched, and then at some point, Partch was in Vancouver and went looking for Al. He was a bit of a wild man, hair and, you know, white beard. And looking for Al, which ended up with him stumbling around in the woods near the house bowl, calling out Al's name. So you can picture Harry Partch, of all people, out in the dark in the woods, yelling for Al. In that area. Hard to imagine a further out image than that. They never did meet, though. Which is fitting, I suppose. And in 1972, we formed a group, a quartet. This is interesting, called the Jazz Pro. Richard Anstey again back on soprano sax, this time, not bass. And Annie Siegel from New York on flute and alto sax. She was going to be here, maybe you read something by her. And amazingly enough, this group didn't do any collages, readings, or performance art. It was straight up instrumental playing, just playing. That was all it was. It only lasted a little while. We played at the Bag, we played at Victoria and Open Space. And later Al would jam here at the front and at Bump's Gallery with some of the players from New York's workshop. Paul Graham, Lyle Ellis, and Paul Bunley, which I helped form in 1977. You know all about New York's workshop, will be for the 40th anniversary last year. And which in many ways continued Al's tradition, because we were also working with poets and filmmakers and dancers, so there was a continuity from the Cellar days, where they put on these things like Crap's Last Tape, which was probably Al's biggest influence in performance. If you know the play Crap's Last Tape by Beckett, that's where he got a lot of his impetus, as well as from Jerry and Artaud and all those people. But perhaps the enduring image I've also seen of Al is of a warmth of spirit and a generosity that continues to inspire us all.
It's a pleasure.
He's been stolen for like 40 years. But he does it, he wears it well.
Thank you very much for that.
Yeah. You know.
I think that, you know, hearing all these stories makes me realize that I'm up here remembering someone that I never met in person. But I met Al in his writing,
I know him,
in his music, in his artwork. That's a way of meeting people. That's a very deep and visceral way of meeting someone. And as someone who does some of that kind of work myself, I'd like to think that that carries on. And Al led a very poetic life, as we've heard, right? So I thought we should at least have a poem. And I wrote a poem about 11 years ago for Al. I don't always write poems about people, and I don't always write poems about jazz musicians. I think the only other poem I ever wrote about a jazz musician was when I was 20 years old. I wrote a piece about Albert Eiler, and his life ended very differently than Al's. Al's lived a long life. And Al is one of the people that is inspiring to me, so that's where this poem came from. I do a little zine that comes out of Denman Island called The Oyster Catcher. So this is the poem that I wrote. It's a short one. And it's been vetted. What I mean is that my good friend Barry brought it over to Al Neal's house one day, and he read it and said, that's okay. So I feel like it's appropriate to read it tonight. I'm also very involved with with surrealism, and was involved in the Chicago Surrealist group. So this is called Surreal Blues. Shaman wailing freely from intertidal piano depths, each note an elixir of musical intoxication, an emotional break with a tired game of standardization. Sounds float like petals, erupt like volcanoes, crash like the waves at Dollarton Beach. Collaged memories of blood and fire form a sound gallery of lost keys, found, assembled, transformed into something else by alchemy. Alchemy. Like a Kabbalah of wrong numbers, connected to each other improvisationally by fluttering gossamer threads, by the thick rope beards of ancient mariners, by the textured flesh of imagination, illuminating a roofless cathedral of shooting stars. Trickster rhythms laughing in the face of death, dancing shoeless in heaven, knowing the profound sadness of beached whales, the lowdown high of the surreal blues. That's B-L-O-O-S.
Who was that?
He's been a lot to us, Al.
So
maybe I'll just end with one story from here that not only did he come and play the piano every day, we used to play together, that was very special. But he would come to all the concerts in Green Bay. He would stand in the back right where Glenn is there, and if he didn't like the concert, he would let everybody know, and he would have to be removed. And if he did like the concert, he would let everybody know. And he would have to be removed. But one time, 1976, the great Anthony Braxton was here from Chicago playing solo alto saxophone. And it was Nicky Carter's first time to Western Rock. And Al was very quiet. And Braxton was up here. And Al crept up the side of the room without anybody looking and got on the piano and started to play along with Anthony Braxton. Anthony Braxton had no idea who this crap was going on. It was quite memorable. I think it's all on video. Anyway, on that note, over to you.